They put their maps up there to try to imagine again what's going on. This is considered being written during his third journey. If you base everything with Syria and Antioch, he had spent a year and a half in Corinth when he started the church. And when they left the church, they sailed across the, Aegean. I get the Aegean and Adriatic. They were both sides. The one between Italy and Greece is Adriatic. The one between Greece and Turkey is Aegean, in my mind. Got a correction? So easy. But they left there and sailed back to Ephesus. Paul, I'm not sure about Silas, Timothy, Priscilla, and Aquila that we know of. And he left Priscilla and Aquila. I don't know about, like I said, I don't know about Silas, don't know about Timothy. Timothy. Then he left and went on down to Caesarea, made a quick trip through Jerusalem. No problem, no trouble, just a report on what he'd done in Europe. I'm not even sure they knew the difference in those days of Europe and Asia. Then he went back to Antioch of Syria. That's his home base. That's where the church is that he's being dispatched from. And spent some time there. I don't remember. Then he decided to go on a third journey. And he pretty much went straight to Ephesus. He went through Tarsus and
Troas?
No, didn't go to Troas. Troas is up north of there. He went through Lystra, Derbe, and Lystra, and did not go through Colossae. If you look at the routes, he misses Colossae. Paul never visited the church at Colossae. The letter that Colossians that he wrote, he never went through the church. He didn't found the church, and he never went through the town. But he went on back to Ephesus, and he got word of all the problems that was going on in Corinth. And that's where these letters come from. Corinth was a messed up town. It was a seaport. As a seaport, the whole Mediterranean nautical world, the maritime merchants and everybody passed through the port of Corinth because they put it on that little land trolley and either transport the cargo and sometimes even the boat over, 3 miles?
A three-mile isthmus.
And they would run head on into Rome, miss that southern Italy, bad sea routes. That's where a lot of the Homer Odyssey stuff comes. They're running around the south end of Greece, and that stormy area, rocky area, all of that.
They said anybody sailed around that would wipe the wheel before they made the trip.
A whole lot of people did that. This is a brief outline of the book. First 11 chapters of 1 Corinthians. He's telling the people in Corinth, you got to straighten up. You got to live right. You're doing this, that, whatever that's not right. Then 12 and 14, he's dealing with spiritual gifts. And then 15 and 16, he gets back into doctrine. He's already taught them a lot of stuff. Now he's writing correction. But the first 11 chapters is because of their lifestyle. I mean, Corinth had the temple to Aphrodite. Temple of Aphrodite was just a big house of prostitution. And you paid for it, which they considered an offering to the god Aphrodite. But Aphrodite didn't spend no money. Whoever the chief priest was, I guess today you call them pimps or madams or something like that. So,
been around a long time.
Been around a long time. Solomon said in Ecclesiastes, nothing new under the sun. We just have faster means of knowing about it and the means of getting there. And what we're hearing now is we still got slavery. We don't hear about that. But there are still people in slavery. All right. First chapter. First 9 verses, we get the typical call, hello to you. And you know, in our memos today, we have to, from, and subject, right? Well, in those days, it was from, then to, and then, how y'all doing? Proud of you. And Paul always starts that way. He says, Paul, called as an apostle, that word is still getting around now. The people from Philippi and Thessalonia are getting down to Corinth too. They know that they're just anti-Paul. So he has to defend his apostleship. By the will of God and Sosthenes. Don't really know who Sosthenes was. There's one man by that name who was the leader of the temple in Thessalonica. They got whooped up for letting Paul board at his house. Never mind. Acts 18:17 might tell you who that is. But this is a letter from Paul. Now, remember too, this is the letter that we have received as it's been put together. The people that study things like this, and you can read it in all different variations. 1 Corinthians is at least 2 letters, they think. Maybe 3. Maybe one's missing. Parts of it are missing. It never got to where they started recording it. And that sometime during this time that Paul was in Ephesus, writing to Corinth, that he may have actually traveled back across the Aegean Sea to say, hey, I'm hearing bad things. We got to straighten this up. This stuff, conjecture. Acts doesn't tell us that. But, you know, what difference does it make? He was working in Ephesus at that church, but he was trying to keep the church at Corinth going. Then he says, to the church of God which is at Corinth, to those who have been sanctified in Christ Jesus. Notice how he puts that. Christ Jesus. Christ is not his name. Jesus of Nazareth. Christ is not his name, it's his title, it's his position, it's the Messiah, it's the Greek version of Messiah. That's what he's about. He puts that first. A lot of other writers and a lot of people today always put Jesus Christ as if Christ is his last name. Those who have been sanctified. What is sanctified? Made holy. And when you're made holy, what are you called? Saints. Been sanctified. Saints by calling. saints' names to be made holy.
Or set apart for the use of God.
Set apart for the use of God. And everybody, I've tried to find the original way I heard it this, but just as there are two sections, smoking and non-smoking, we go to, the people, there are two classes of people. There are saints and there are ain'ts.
Ain'ts.
You're either a saint or you ain't. And the saints are the sheep, when he divides the sheep to the goats, the saints are the sheep, the ain'ts are the goats.
The saints are the non-smoking side.
They're on the non-smoking side. And who are the saints? All who, all who, in every place, call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours. That's who saints are. That you call on the name of the Lord Jesus. Not that you say the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, but that you call regularly, routine. He's not a spare tire. He's the pilot. That's what most people... I'm glad that bumper sticker went away. Once I learned what it meant and what it bothered me. God is never my co-pilot. If he's not my pilot, then I'm alone. Then he gives thanks. I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God which was given you in Christ Jesus, that in everything you were enriched in him, in all speech and all knowledge, even as the testimony concerning Christ was confirmed in you, so that you're not lacking in any gift, awaiting eagerly for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will also confirm you to the end, blameless in the days of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, through whom you were called into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. He's talking about the parousia. Always remember those two words in reading this letter. Much of what he says is strictly based on parousia and hostophy. What did the people of the time think about? Then he gets into the problems. He gets into what the letter is all about. Now I exhort you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all agree, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be made complete in the same mind and in the same judgment. For I have been informed concerning you, my brethren, by Chloe's people, that there are quarrels among you. Now I mean this, that each of you is saying, I am of Paul, or I of Apollos, or I of Cephas, of Christ. Who is Apollos? Do I remember? Apollos was the intellectual who came up from Egypt. Alexander. On the coast of Egypt.
And he was brought up to speed on his Christianity.
He was brought up, he came to Ephesus, and he was preaching the baptism of John the Baptist. He knew the Old Testament well. He was a great orator. He was probably a philosopher, just an intelligent guy. But he wasn't up to speed on Jesus. He knew that John the Baptist had prophesied on Jesus. But he didn't know about you. And Priscilla and Aquila brought him up to speed. They took him aside and says, you need to learn. Well, that was in Ephesus. He left Ephesus and went on to Corinth. Went across the Aegean. He had heard that there was a church over there. They knew. They helped start it. So course, went over there and became a evangelist, sort of, a teacher. Because remember, those people were mostly Gentiles. Gentiles, you can't assume they know the Old Testament. So they needed Hebrew-trained people to bring up to speed of what Christ was saying. Has Christ been divided? This is Paul again. Paul was not crucified for you, was he? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? And he goes on and says, I'm thankful I didn't baptize a lot of folks. Because he, there's verse 17 there that there's a lot of discussion on. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not in cleverness of speech, so that the cross of Christ would not be made void. Now, Dr. Harold Wilmington commented on that. I was in a meeting with Dr. Wilmington, was in that meeting with Jonathan the other day. So I was in the same room with him, didn't get a chance to meet him. But he says this line, Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. He says that is a point that can be made, that baptism is not necessary for salvation. Baptism is a sign to the rest of the world that I am in Christ, and Christ is in me. But if baptism is not one of the requirements to claim salvation.
I guess that's the initial sign of what you believe in. And then several years later, it's how you have lived your life that is a sign.
Here's what Dr. Williams said. Christ didn't send me to baptize, but to preach the good news is probably the strongest biblical argument against the view that one must be baptized to be saved. And coming out of a strong Baptist center like he does, that's a strong statement. It's necessary to prove to others that you've accepted Christ. When you were baptized, you were already saved. I think that's the point that needs to be stressed. It is a public appearing. And a note I found somewhere else, baptism is not a part of a gospel message. It's a reaction to the gospel message. Now, a misunderstanding of the message in B1 on our outline here. Paul says, for the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. He has some strong comments here for intellectual folks. He asks, where is the wise man? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? I was looking at that, and I said, that's two ways to take that. Did he make it foolish, or does he make it foolish with his truth? Either way, it's fun to play with those words. Paul says, has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world through his wisdom did not come to know God, God was well pleased through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For indeed, Jews ask for signs and Greeks search for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to Jews a stumbling block, and to Gentiles foolishness.
Yeah, that kind of fits in how he picked his apostles. He did pick wisdom well-educated folks, fishermen, most of them.
He took fat people. Can't remember what the F is about. A is available and T is teachable. Faithful.
Faithful, available.
Faithful, available, and teachable. So.
So that's another way.
All of the apostles were fat people.
Right. African.
Doesn't sound, it's a good way to insult them and then come down.
That's like that mule between the eyes of two before.
Yeah. Before you whisper in his ear.
Before you whisper in his ear.
Yeah. And Paul goes on to say, the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. Consider your calling, brother. There are not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to shame the things which are strong or which who think they are strong. And the base things of the world and the despised God has chosen the things that are not, so that he may nullify the things that are, so that no man can boast. So he's putting down ministry, the intellectuals. People says, I don't believe because of, doesn't make sense. No, doesn't make sense. Unless you want it to. Anytime you think that your intelligence is greater than anybody else, and you think that people who believe in a higher power are just plain foolish. Just forgiven. We may be foolish, but we're forgiven.
And our smartest scientists, they can't even, a group of them, can't even make one blade of grass grow. They can take the seed.
They can make the conditions the way it will grow.
That are already there. Yeah. Earth, sun, then they can do something with it.
And even with all the chemists, they can't produce honey.
That's right.
You can't synthesize honey. You can't. There is no artificial honey.
Nor the venom that comes out of that little sac on the backside. They cannot produce that.
So, there's things that they can't talk about. Sort of like, I remember Navy days, we had a, this is back before SEALs. They were the frogmen, underwater demolition units in the Navy. And we had some Marine, the Army calls them Rangers, the Marine calls them Pathfinders. We had a crew of frogmen and a crew of Pathfinders aboard ship. Over in the med, the frogmen, you know, that was a scrawny bunch of guys. They were just a, you wouldn't know they were military. But the Pathfinders, they
home screen.
They were spit and polish Marines. Had their technician in the shop one day and asked him, how do you guys stack up against the Rangers? Hey, no. Nothing to do. I mean, we're better than they are. Well, what about the frogmen? Well, now that's a different story. The order of their order of responsibility. The frogman headed to the beach, from where he could see it to where he could get on the beach. That was frogman territory. The Pathfinders had the beach area. Then they turned it over to the Rangers when you got inland. That's the way God makes people think. It's we're better than they are. What about these guys? That's questionable. Paul goes on, I did not come with superiority of speech or wisdom. I came knowing nothing came among you knowing nothing except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That's what he preached. That's what he taught them. My message and my preaching were not in persuasive words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith would not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God. That's what Paul is telling the people in Corinth. You've got the foundation. We have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit. That's a capital letter and a lowercase. We have received not the spirit, lowercase, of the world, but the Spirit, capital S, who is from God, so that we may pray, that we may know the things freely given by God. Not words taught by human wisdom, but in those taught by the Spirit. That's why we say Bible study should be done in prayer and meditation, not with the commentary. Don't read the commentary first to see what you're going to read in Scripture, but in prayer and meditation, read the Scripture and see what it says. Now, in 2, a misunderstanding of the ministry. What then is Apollos, and what is Paul? Servants through whom you believe, even as the Lord gave opportunity to each one. I planted, Apollos watered, but God was causing the growth. As your phrase, they can't make the grass grow, they can make the conditions right to where the grass will grow, but they can't make the grass grow. You can lead a horse, you can lead a mule to water, but you can't make him drink it. You lead a horse to water and he'll drink himself to death.
In chapter 2?
I'm approaching 3, yeah.
You're in 3.
I'm fixing to go, no, yeah.
Yeah.
3:5. Yeah, 3:5. That's what it says right there. 3:5 to 4:5. So then neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything but God who causes the growth. For we are God's fellow workers. What does that mean?
Well, so to see. We work.
And we make the conditions.
We make the conditions.
Like a wise builder, I laid the foundation and another is building on it. But each man must be careful how he builds on it. But there's only one foundation, which is Jesus Christ. Now here's an interesting passage. I wish I, this is sermon material. Now, if any man builds on the foundation, I don't know which verse, it's probably 12 or 13. If any man builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each man's work will become evident, for the day will show it, because it is to be revealed with fire. What does it say? We build on the foundation of Christ. It is possible to build on it with gold, silver, precious stones. What happens to them in fire? Nothing. Gold melts. If it's pure gold, nothing else happens, right? I don't know about silver. I assume it can be burned. Precious stones. Worst they'll do is fracture under heat. But wood, hay, and straw, what happens to it?
It'll burn up.
It'll burn up. And each man's work is tested by fire. Now, it's the next line. If, and this is verse 14, if any man's work which he has built on it remains, he will receive a reward. Okay, if you build with gold, silver, or precious stones, you'll get a reward. What if you don't? If any man's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire.
You lose your rewards.
That's a question I'm not sure I understand. What are our rewards? But it doesn't, if we don't do a good job, God will let us know. But he won't take our salvation away for it.
No, because he'll forgive us.
It goes back, I guess, to the attitude that we did what we did. You build something with pride and self-righteousness, then it's going to get burned up. That's a sin. If you never recognize that sin, it gets in flaky areas that I've never been sure about. But to do a poor job is not losing your salvation. Do you not know that you are a temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? That's an illustration you hear a lot. Our bodies are temples of God. If any man destroys the temple of God, God will destroy him. For the temple of God is holy. And that is what you are. We are holy. We are set aside, dedicated, self-professed children of God. His servants. Not necessarily his slaves, but his servants. That's a big discussion among the clergy, the professional clergy. Are we a servant or are we a slave? I think we're servants because we claim kinship with Christ because we're all God's children.